We often speak of influence. I'm sure there are those people who use that word. I don't know that they always know what it means. But we each have influence over others. Part of fellowship is influence. Influence is that power we have over others that doesn't necessarily have to do and only have to do with the words we speak to them and the message in those words that we convey. That influence of which I speak has to do with practicing that which we know, and people then can observe our example. And we either set a bad example or a good example. I don't know of any other kind of example you can set. And the child of God who's serious about being a child of God, a member of the Lord's church, a Christian, citizen of the kingdom of heaven, a member of the body of Christ, that person is serious about setting godly examples. First of all, we have the example in this area of influence and us being Christians wielding the Christian influence in the very life of Christ. We have to know that Christ came into this world to influence the world. We've often said sin is the big problem man has. Christ is the great physician. And the whole, he said, don't need a physician. It's the sick that need a physician. He came to show how God would live as a man. And that's an amazing thing. He came to show us how God would live as a man. And thus, he was as much of a human being as you are or I am. Such a character as Napoleon, in speaking of a living force, had this to say, and I quote, "But can you conceive of a dead man making conquest with an army faithful and entirely devoted to his memory? My armies have forgotten me even while living, as the Carthaginian army forgot Hannibal. Such is our power. A single battle lost crushes us, and adversity scatters our friends." But you know, that hasn't been the case with Christ. If you go back to the beginning of the church and the great persecution that arose against the church in Jerusalem after the martyrdom of Stephen, then the disciples were persecuted so much they had to leave, they had to run. Only the apostles remained in Jerusalem. But then they went everywhere, and the Bible says they went everywhere preaching the word. The very thing that brought that persecution on them, wherever they went, when they were fleeing for their lives, they preached that which brought the persecution on them. Can you conceive of Caesar as the eternal emperor of the Roman Senate? Yet from the depths of his mausoleum, if he were buried, wherever they scattered his ashes, if they burned his body, watching over the destinies of Rome. But when you consider Christianity, Christ died, was buried, and was raised to die no more. And all that's been done to influence the world for Jesus Christ was done after he went back to heaven, because he placed the gospel in the hands of mortal men. God never speaks from the day of Pentecost forward to a man and says, "I'm going to tell you right now what you must do to be saved." Have you ever noticed that? Take Saul's own conversion. And when he is struck down, if you please, by that great light, when he was headed for Damascus to persecute Christians, he asked who the Lord was. "I'm Jesus of Nazareth, whom thou persecutest." Well, of course, he was persecuting the church, and he was intending to do that, which shows the close affinity and attachment the Lord as the head has to the church and the body that he saves. You persecute a Christian, you persecute Christ. Yet you find that it was through that kind of life, that kind of power of example, that the gospel truth was wielded throughout the world. It wasn't a matter of just saying words. It was the way they lived. We often use that to say, why would the apostles suffer terrible persecution and death if they preached a lie? No man who is in his right mind preaches that which he knows is a lie, telling you all the time it's the truth, when he's about to be nailed to a cross for preaching it. No one operates that way. Common sense in the mind of a normal human says that doesn't happen. But they did. They died regularly. They would not compromise the gospel. Now, it's true the words of the gospel must be understood, believed, and obeyed. But look at the example they set. And look at the influence for good they wielded. In this case, in Stephen's case, Paul's case, whatever, they would not yield what they believed, what they knew was right. They would not compromise the truth. Our country is sorely in need of this from members of the Lord's church. We have known such a happy state of affairs in these United States since its beginning in the freedom of religion, and so much of the people of these nations being grounded in believing in the God of the Bible, the Christ, the Holy Spirit, understanding salvation is through Christ, and so much, even though there's false doctrine involved and corruption, that anchored people, but that's changing, isn't it? What will we be called upon to do in the future? Especially our children and our grandchildren. What will they have to sacrifice in the true sense of sacrifice, such as Stephen did when he died for the cause of Christ? Is our faith that strong? Because we have had it really so easy. But think what a great influence that is. Now, coming back to parents, children see in their parents what makes them much of what they are. God meant it to be that way, but you can be a bad influence, bad example, or a good influence. When children grow up in a home, will they have the idea that I'm not to compromise the truth of the gospel? That I'm to stand up and be counting that God exists, Christ is deity, the Bible's the word of God, the truth of the gospel and the church, his organization, work and worship, when the great majority never has accepted that? Well, it's one thing to have people smile at you or get mad at you or grit their teeth at you, but they don't stop you from preaching it. It's another thing to be put in prison because you preach the gospel. Do you know of anyone in the United States who's ever been put into prison simply because they preached the gospel of Jesus Christ to people who didn't want to hear it? I don't. Maybe you do. I don't. And doesn't that kind of rattle your mind a bit to think that that could happen? But that was all too common when you read your New Testament, wasn't it? How is it that we can divorce ourselves from the Bible we claim to care so much about, to believe in so much? And yet we read there in the first century that preaching what I preach regularly to this pulpit got people killed and run out of town. It happened a lot in Europe under Roman Catholicism. And then it happened even more when Protestantism started its work in the late 1400s through the 1600s. Sometime if you think it's only the Catholics that have done the evil they have done, and history records it, read what John Calvin did when he controlled Switzerland. And if you did not submit to what he understood to be what was God's will, you were in bad shape. So it's been done. You go into the Tower of London in England, and they'll show you various torture instruments that were used on folks for political reasons, but also because of religious reasons. It was regularly done. You can still see, and I think I've mentioned this, we went to one church building, which, of course, in the 1600s, it would have been way out in the country, and it was in the country then when I saw it a few years ago. And yet, because this church was not adhering to the Church of England's doctrine, then they had to have someone watching. And the road is still there, still a lane, about a half a mile. So they'd have people there, remember, traveling by walking or wagon or horses. Take a little while to travel a half mile or a quarter mile. And so behind the pulpit, there's a hole. And the preacher kept his horse tied outside so he could go through there, mount his horse, and he's gone. Looked like a hayloft opening in the back of the church building. I guess he didn't meet him at the door to shake hands and see how they thought about his sermon when the king's men were all coming down the road. We don't even think about that. Isn't that foreign to your mind to think, oh, that never happened here? Truth of the matter is, what we've known in America is the exception. It's the special thing. It's the once in a thousand years bright light that we've known to have these kind of freedoms. We've become so used to it, we just think everybody's that way. So my point is, yes, we know we're to wield the Christian influence by living godly examples, putting into practice what the New Testament says in our choices and our planning and being the families we ought to be and how we are at work and school and wherever. But what about under duress? Would we stand? You younger men with young families, what's going to happen to your wife and child if you're put in jail for being a Christian? What are they going to do? Well, that'd never happen, would it? It's not happening in these United States, and it won't happen only because of the good providence of God Almighty, because most of the time throughout history that kind of thing has happened when it comes to the persecution of individual Christians and godly people, even in the Old Testament. But we are still the only Bibles the careless world will read, as the poet said. We are the sinner's gospel. We are the scoffer's creed. And someone else came along and wrote, you are writing a gospel, a chapter each day. By the deeds that you do and the words that you say, men read what you write, whether faithless or true. Say, what is the gospel according to you? We must remember that. I said in the beginning of the lesson that the kingdom is the church and the church is the kingdom, and both are simply terms that refer to the body of Christ, the realm of the saved, the family of God. But in Matthew 13:33, I read, the kingdom of heaven is like unto leaven, which a woman took and hid in three measures of meal, till it was all leavened. Now the Lord is teaching there what we are to be to the world. And we can't be that way by just simply slip-sliding around, afraid somebody will find out I am a Christian, and all of the Bible teaches that word to mean, and what we're to be to rightfully wear it. But even today, with the freedoms we enjoy, we kind of find it hard to say something to somebody if they're using very bad language on the job. Do you feel like you'll say something to them about it? Or do you just put up with it? Telling dirty jokes, do we say anything about it? Do we try to explain to them why that's offensive to us? You know, we are living in the age when everybody's offended at everything. So why couldn't I begin with that and say, you know, we're living in an age where things are offended, everybody speaks they're offended. Let me tell you why your bad language offends me. That'd get their attention. Some of us have been in a few of those situations, and I've been always amazed at how people are so taken back when you say something they don't hardly know what to do. And it sure is a good time when they're still mouth agape to teach a little lesson. This particular parable in Matthew 13 relates to the powerful influence of the kingdom in the world. Well, the kingdom's people, the redeemed. And that means the powerful influence of you and me in the world. Again, Jesus said at one time, "Ye are the salt of the earth," Matthew 5:13. And we all know that salt has been used through the ages as an agent of influence in the preservation of meats. You know, with my high blood pressure here a couple years ago, we were doing all we can. Joe did a great job of cutting out the salt. And nowadays, if I eat something that used to be normally tasting salt, it tastes too salty, all that. So I was telling the doctor how we were doing that, and he listened, and he said, "Well, now remember this, you do need some salt to live." You know, moderation helps in those cases, even when you need to rectify things. So it's always been used to preserve meats and things like that. So the metaphor teaches that Christ's disciples are to be agents of influence in preserving the world. Think about it. Preserving the world from putrefaction, corruption, and destruction in the matter of morals and spiritual things. Israel of old was expected to keep God's name alive among the pagan nations. That's one of the great reasons God punished them so much, is because God expected them down through the centuries to be an example of what His people were. And yet so often they did what? Compromise and go the way of the people all around them. And, of course, if you go back to just Noah's day, there wasn't enough salt in the world to save everything. There just wasn't any salt for the good that the world needed, Genesis 6, 5 through 7. We could say the same thing about Sodom, chapter 18 of Genesis. Wasn't enough salt, wasn't enough good influence, wasn't enough good people, good as the Bible defines the good, in those places and in the world to save them from destruction. Somebody says, "Well, when is the Lord going to come back? When is it going to be the end of the world?" Well, I think it'll be something like that. I just don't know when that's going to be. Nobody else does either. We have pictures of God visiting destruction upon people who deserved it. And His mercy is amazing. His long-suffering baffles me constantly when I read of it in the Bible. Yet there's a point men will reach where God will say, "That's enough. I'm through with the system." And of course, He's omniscient, so He knows all that the object of knowledge. He already knows that time out there in the future some point. What are we to do in this period of time? We are His influence in the world. We are His hands. We are His feet. We are His mouth. We are His influence in the world as His children in the church. Christ also said, "Ye are the light of the world," in Matthew 5:14. Light dispels darkness. That's how it influences things. So it's used again metaphorically here. The good works, they're good works because we abide by the teaching of the Bible, the teaching of it, the pattern of it. What do? They dispel spiritual darkness. What do you think a homosexual would do if you very kindly said to him, "How do you know you're right as a homosexual?" But we won't say that, will we? We're usually too scared to say something like that. Well, what's wrong with saying? Paul gave this command to the Christians at Ephesus, talking about where they came from spiritually and where they were. "For ye were once darkness, but are now light in the Lord." Now watch. "Walk as children of light," Ephesians 5:8. That means live your lives according to the teaching of the New Testament. You're converted. You used to be like everybody else at Ephesus. And you don't have to leave what the Bible says about Ephesus to know what a mess it was, as was all the Roman world. So how did they change those people over a period of years? How did they get them to leave all that kind of thing? Well, they wielded the Christian influence. They not only taught the gospel. I'm not trying to say the gospel doesn't need to be taught as you read those sermons in your New Testament, but I'm talking about how they lived around these people every day. They did not participate in what they did, and they gave them a reason why. That's what Peter's talking about when he says, "If any man speak, speak as the oracles of God." Or when he says, "Be ready to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason of the hope that's in you with meekness and fear." That's make a defense of what you're doing. What are you people doing down there every Sunday? What's the big deal? Well, let me tell you about it. Can you imagine some Gentile asking Paul about why he preached so long at Troas and the commotion when Eutychus fell out of the window and they raised him from the dead, went back up? Can you imagine? You think that was done in a corner? All those things that we consider sometimes to be, oh, woe is me. Well, what that's going to do to me turned out to be a great opportunity. And, of course, Paul is the greatest example I think of among men, because he went to Jerusalem, falsely accused, all that turmoil in the council. He's arrested and all of this. He has to use his Roman citizenship. He appears before the council. They almost pull him in pieces. At least the chief captain thought that what was going to happen to him, because he knew he wasn't going to get any fair hearing there. And he said, I'm a Pharisee, the son of a Pharisee of the hope of the resurrection, am I called in question. Well, that put the Sadducees and Pharisees at one another's throats, and that's when evidently he was in the middle of that row. And now, would you be there? Would you be involved in that? Would you want your preacher to be involved in that? I can see how some people want their preacher to be involved in it, as long as he would go and they'd stay home. But they were wrecked. That was Paul's lot. Do you remember in Ephesus how that Paul wanted to go into Colosseum and the whole city was in an uproar and the brethren wouldn't let him? And even when he went to Jerusalem, it was prophesied. Remember Agabus said they took Paul's girdle and wrapped himself. Said, this is what the Jews are going to do to the man whose girdle this belongs. And so they begged him not to go. There were two times that inspiration, or rather I should say, God spoke directly via the prophets and said, this is what's going to happen to you if you go to Jerusalem. But he said, I'm going anyway. They begged him not to. He said, look, I'm not only ready to be bound in Jerusalem, but to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord. And you know what the brethren did? They said, so be it, if that's the way it is. Influence. It demands proper conduct on our part. It demands that we speak up when it's easier to be silent. And that's hard to do sometimes. A Christian wife is commanded to win her non-Christian husband to the Lord by her godly living. It doesn't mean she can never teach him the gospel. It just means she puts the gospel into practice in her life. In like manner, you wives, be in subjection to your own husbands. And this is the American Standard, that even if any obey not the word, they may without the word be gained by the behavior of their wives, beholding your chaste behavior coupled with fear. 1 Peter 3, 1 and 2. What do they see? They see a woman that's going to be what the Bible says a wife ought to be and a mother ought to be, and she's not going to compromise the truth regarding whatever the Christian life demands of her. And it was certainly a change of things in that day and age as to the way the people normally live when a person became a Christian. This passage, if no other passage, shows the great power of Christian influence over the non-Christian life. People know what you do, and they may not understand it. And if you can continue on, they may ask why. We ought to work, in fact, around non-Christians to make them ask why. Or if they don't, why not ask them, why are you what you are? We ought not to be a stumbling block. We ought to be uncompromising. We ought to choose things that might be right for us to reject them, but they're not wrong or right within themselves. So we choose them because they're encouragement to somebody else, or the same way leaving things undone. The only way you can show your faith to anybody else is by your obedience, by your works. That was well pointed out recently on Wednesday night. Show me thy faith apart from thy works, and I by my works will show thee my faith. James 2:18. And then, of course, there's always the need to serve others. Matthew 23:11. But he that is greatest among you shall be your servant. There's no place for selfishness and self-centeredness and self-will, those attitudes in the church among members. You do wield an influence when you're that way, but it's not an influence for good. Matthew 20:28, the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister. As you therefore have opportunity to do good unto all men, especially they of the household of faith. Christ shall be magnified in my body, Paul said, whether by life or by death, Philippians 1:20. So our influence is so important. I said the other day, and this is partially what brought this sermon on, I said some things about the identifying marks of the Church of our Lord that set it apart from human institutions founded and sustained, such as they are, on the commandments and doctrines of men. And rightly so, we often point out the church, its work, its organization, its worship, and so on. The plan of salvation, the right division of the word, how that sets the Lord's church apart from human churches. But brethren, the greatest thing in the case of getting people to pay attention to those things is the lives we live before our neighbors on the job, at school, before family members that are not members of the church. I think we've scared ourselves, nice way of saying it, into being afraid to speak up and say, I'm sorry to disagree with you, but that's not right. Or, that's not what the Bible teaches on that point. You'll either engender greater interest on their part, or you'll shut them up. I don't mean to want to shut them up, but when people find out that somebody knows something about the Bible, and they really don't want to know about it, they're happy with what they've got because that's just what it is. I found that out firsthand as a very young man in state schools. You know how old boys are in state schools. At least you, not by experience, may know it, but you know it by the way they are, just by the world. You don't have to do anything, but just invite them to go to Bible study in church with you. That sure does change the conversation. That's all you got to do. And then the other thing is, when they start using bad language, you say, why do you do that? You can always put things in the form of a question, and you're not just saying, you're wrong. You say, tell me why you do that. Why do you curse? Would you explain that to me? Oh, they can get mad. But as I said earlier, most of the time I found out that they just didn't really know what to do. It sure did open up some doors. You see how we can be an influence for good, and yet we're around these all the time, wondering why we can't set up Bible studies, wondering why we can't find out about people. And I want you to know, in fact, I'll tell you the truth, as a preacher, because 99% of the time I'm around members of the church, I don't get to do that anymore. Now I'm glad to be in the polish and water what somebody else where somebody else has planted, that's fine. But because I don't work in a secular world, quote, quote, I'm around brethren most of the time. I'm around my neighbors. That's the closest I think probably we have of being around people very much that are not members, so we can try to influence them for good. But I do remember when I was, and I do know opportunities to try to take. Now, that's a lot of eyes on my part. But what gave me the idea to do some of those things? Sometimes just being bold. Just speaking up. Here's what I mean by all that. How do you become a good speaker? How? By speaking. How do you become a good listener in all the art of listening? By listening. How did your baby learn to walk? By walking. How did your baby and how did you learn to talk? By talking. And how do you grow in the knowledge and likeness of Christ? By doing exactly what the Bible said and the way it said it and for the reason it said it. It was meant to be that way. There's something about the growth that says when you know it and you do it, then it works to know more. It opens more doors up. It builds on that. While if you just study it like you might study a history book, learn things about it, fine. But what do you put into practice about studying about the Battle of San Jacinto? I don't know of anything to put into practice. You might learn some things people did that might be wise in how you make choices. But the Bible was meant to be internalized and motivate our thinking and how we make choices and who we associate with. I'll show you one of the first ones that comes out in people's lives. Finding a mate for life. That goes a long way into putting into practice Christian principles when you lay down the groundwork whereby you're going to make your choice. But what does it mean to raise your children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord? Well, first of all, it has to do with setting good examples before them and being godly mamas and daddies. And then actual sitting down and teaching them the Bible. And then training them in the application of what you taught them, what that means, and putting those things into practice. I've seen a lot of folks, it reminds me of a great extent of many college professors. They can give you the information. They're sort of like an encyclopedia. And they probably know more about whatever their subject matter is than anybody else. But don't expect a whole lot of internalizing if they're in that kind of discipline of study and putting it into their lives. In other words, there are a lot of psychiatrists who need that help as much as the people they treat. In fact, among MDs, those are the ones that have the highest percentage of suicides. Something's missing somewhere, folks. And so what we're saying is, when we sum it all up, to be a good influence for the Lord as a member of His church and faithful to His cause, if the Lord says do something and you've never done it, know that He didn't tell you if He thought you couldn't do it. Just get up and do it. That's how you grow. That's how you get better. That's how you wield the Christian influence, whether it's in your home, whether it's in the church before the brethren to strengthen them spiritually, or whether it's out in the world. You can speak up for yourself. In reality, in employing the truth of God, when you speak up, who are you speaking up for? Your Lord and your Savior, Jesus Christ. I heard a voice from heaven saying, John wrote, write, blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors. Now listen. For their works follow after, American Standard says, with them. Revelation 14, 13. Now, I close the lesson on this point. When I'm dead and gone, I'll still be influencing people on this earth till this world's over with. But it's not just me. It's everybody that's ever lived. The influence of parents' lives and the lives of their children. Paul said, having been reminded of the unfeigned faith that is in thee, speaking of Timothy, which dwelt first in thy grandmother Lois and in thy mother Eunice, and I am persuaded in thee also, 1 Timothy 1:5. He also said of this young preacher that from a babe thou hast known the sacred writings, 2 Timothy 3:15. Now, did he just pick up the Bible at 4 years old and read it in view of how the Bible was in those days? No, he had it read to him. He had it taught to him. His grandmother and mother exemplified it in their conduct. Think of men in secular fields, and then we'll close the lesson, and what an influence they are. We hear people speaking of Abraham Lincoln, George Washington, and on you can go. Their lives still influence us. But how much more important is it for each member of the church in this select small body of God's family on earth that we work to help each other through our influence, our conduct, to be stronger in the Lord, that we might teach others the pure, unadulterated gospel of Jesus Christ and have the church as you read of it and as it appears on the pages of the New Testament. So I close with lives of great men all remind us we can make our lives sublime. And departing, leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. Footprints that perhaps another sailing o'er life's solemn main, a forlorn shipwrecked brother, seeing, may take heart again. So let's remember all of this. Let's know that it's something, as long as we live on this earth and have our faculties about us, you never attain to it. But it's something that's always there to move us, to guide us, to encourage us, to keep us wielding the influence God says that He wants His church and the individual members to wield before the world and before one another. If you're not a child of God, the greatest influence that you can be is to show other people your humble attitude toward God, your willingness to believe in Jesus Christ and repent of all your sins, whatever they may be, moral or spiritual, to confess your faith in Him and be willing to do it publicly, and then obey Him completely and being baptized into Christ for the remission of sins. Then in the church of the Lord, His church, serve Him faithfully by wielding the Christian influence. If you stumble from time to time in sinning and you haven't repented of them, then know the second law of pardon is to repent, confess those sins, and pray God for forgiveness, to live again faithful the Christian life and the great influence it is to a lost and dying world. If you're subject to the great invitation of our Lord, we invite you to come while we stand and sing.
Why can't you?